Good evening, friends, visitors, Bostonians, Democrats, communists, revolutionaries, all those who struggle for peace and justice and a better world. Welcome to this historic conference. Can you hear me? Thank you. This first panel is concerned with the export of U.S. anti-communism, and we'll take a look at that history and specific explanations of its consequences by those of us who've been its victims and perhaps those of us who would be victims. Each panel participant would engage us in a record of ruthless assault, no doubt, but we hope also that we would find in each presenter an agenda and a disposition towards an anti-communist antithesis, real justice, real freedom, real liberation, and real socio-economic progress for their constituencies and ours, the peoples of the world. In introducing this panel, let me say the following, that U.S. domestic and foreign policies, and they must be taken together, have both been media for the transfer of an ideologically hostile, perhaps a hegemonic attitude towards the rest of the world. There's been a dominant presence of anti-communism, with anti-Sovietism being its most explicit and fervent form in the immediate post-World War II period. The specific policy of containment of communism and containment of Soviet influence has been the bedrock of U.S. foreign policy following its exposition by George Kennan and its acceptance by successive administrations since 1947. But while we have seen unabated containment as a policy, at times even rollback, we have seen towards the developing countries in particular, and I refuse to use the term third world, by the way. I reject it in my own philosophical growth, I should say. I cannot see how we, as a human race, could be designated in hierarchies. I think it is both morally and politically unacceptable. But we in the developing countries, we've been the target of another specific specific objective. The objective as a political and ideological objective that precedes anti-communism, the objective of imperialist expansion. And this has been expressed through multiple forms of intervention, the Monroe Doctrine of 1823 being the basis for this in the Western Hemisphere. Without exception, whenever U.S. elites have sought to justify the myriad of over 200 military interventions in the world, or to perpetuate its Gramscian hegemonic rule at home and abroad, anti-communism has been its clarion call. But it has been laid within the bed of seeking expansionist objectives abroad. In the Americas, stemming the tide of popular movements, retarding progressive nationalism, or assaulting socialist initiatives have been done in the name of freedom and democracy, synonyms for anti-communism. In my own country, Grenada, when the indomitable leader Maurice Bishop and the courageous Grenadian people began a search for self-determination, using our indigenous cultural and ideological formation, very simply we call it participatory democracy, President Ronald Reagan assailed the Grenada Revolution, identifying it, in his words, a communist threat to U.S. national security. And using a combination of economic and propaganda destabilization, attempts at diplomatic isolation, CIA and other covert operations, which we now know to be more expansive in the reports of Constantine Mengis's new book. And finally, a full-fledged military invasion. The US government overthrew the Grenada Revolution in the name of anti-communism. Subsequently, a national poll indicated that the invasion was justified. Another sad and tragic indicator of what we are here to look at, the export of US anti-communism. But we go back in history and begin with our first speaker, Dr. Cheddi Jagan, distinguished Latin American, a distinguished American. Dr. Jagan is the former Prime Minister of Guyana, has twice been overthrown in coups attributed to the American Institute of Free Labor Development, a CIA-controlled labor organization, and with the compliance and support of the British intelligence apparatus. He has been twice denied the leadership of his country, in part because he is a Marxist. Dr. Jagan is currently leader of the opposition People's Progressive Party, the PPP, and I grew up, Dr. Jagan, knowing that the PPP was one of the revolutionary organizations in the Caribbean, and I salute you, 25 years in the leadership of the People's Progressive Party. Before bringing him to the podium, I want to say two perhaps little-known facts about this distinguished American fighter. First, that he has been honored by the highest national awards from countries as diverse as Cuba and the Soviet Union, Bulgaria and Hungary. And secondly, I want to share with you the finding of a Caribbean writer, Festus Brotherson, writing recently in Caribbean Contact, one of our region's newspapers, in its November 1988 issue. And Mr. Brotherson says, and I quote, "Some members have revealed themselves to me and claimed that the actual results of the 1985 poll in Guyana reveals that had not President Hoyt, but Cheddi Jagan winning the next election, had there not been electoral fraud and military intervention. I give you the would-be president, the people, Caribbean people's hero, Dr. Cheddi Jagan."
Cover Chairman, friends all. 3 decades separate the landing of troops in British Guiana in 1953 and in Grenada in 1983. In the former, the soldiers were British. In the latter, American. But common to both events and many others was anti-communism. Anti-communism, as we know, raised its head immediately after that great event in history, the Great October Socialist Revolution. We had it manifested in this country with the Palmer Raids, and of course after the Second World War, when socialism became a world system, with socialist countries in North Korea, in South Korea, in North Korea and North Vietnam, and Eastern Europe establishing people's democracies. It is in this context of a change in the balance of world forces that imperialism said, "Halt, enough, we must stop you." And it is in this context that the Cold War was started by the arch-imperialist Churchill, whose government sent the troops to Guyana in 1953. But before that, he had come to Fulton, Missouri in 1946 and really sounded the clarion call, anti-communist, and the declaration of the Cold War. A year after, President Truman declared the Cold War. And in a speech at Baylor University on March the 6th, he made a speech on foreign economic policy, which clearly stated that governments which conducted planned economies and controlled foreign trade were dangerous to freedom, that freedom of speech and worship were dependent on the free enterprise system. He pointed out that controlled economies were not the American way and not the way of peace. He urged that the whole world should adopt the American system, and that the American system could survive in America only if it became a world system. Calling for action, he implored, quote, "Unless we act and act decisively, it," that meaning government-controlled economy and government-controlled foreign trade, "will be the pattern of the next century," unquote. Requesting aid for Greece and Turkey, which the bankrupt government, British government, was handing over to the Americans, Truman attacked the communists as a militant minority for creating political chaos and urged that if the United States were to realize its objectives, it must be willing to help free peoples to maintain their free institutions and their national integrity against aggressive movements that seek to impose upon them totalitarian regimes, quote, unquote. To make the American free enterprise capitalist system into a world system, a global strategy, military, political, economic, diplomatic, and psychological, was devised. An iron ring of military bases was established under treaties for different regions of the world. The Rio Treaty for Latin America and the Caribbean, NATO for the North Atlantic, the Baghdad Pact, later called CENTO after the Iraq Revolution of 1958, that for the Middle East, SEATO, and the ANZUS Pact for the Far East. All this meant to contain communism, to roll back socialism, and arrest national liberation worldwide. And the methods used were direct military intervention, as in Guyana in 1953, as in the Dominican Republic in 1965, and later in Vietnam. Indirect intervention, as in Guatemala in 1954, and later indirect intervention against Cuba with the Bay of Pigs invasion in 1961. And then there was a familiar destabilization, what was called destabilization, by the CIA, covert action. They started out against the Mossadegh government in June, a few months after, again a year after, in Guatemala, and then in Chile in 1973, and against the Manley government in 1980. So these were some of the methods which were used. But what happened in British Guiana, Iran, Guatemala, elsewhere were not isolated events. They coincided with the people, with the period of intense McCarthyism inside the United States. Under Senator Joseph McCarthy's Reg with Hunting Un-American Activities Committee, American patriots, politicians, administrators, journalists, writers, actors, including the learned black scholar Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois and the famous actor-singer Paul Robeson, were hounded, blacklisted, and some were jailed. The Eisenhower and Kennedy administrations initiated U.S. involvement in Vietnam, and President Kennedy gave the green light for the Bay of Pigs invasion of Cuba and CIA destabilization of our third PPP government in Guyana in the 1961-64 period. Under President Johnson, the Johnson Doctrine, the U.S. government, after the armed intervention in the Dominican Republic with 42,000 troops assume the right to intervene in any Latin American country which it considered was threatened by communism. Under Nixon's Vietnamization policy, after the fiasco there, Asians, Africans, and Latin Americans were to become the instruments of their own subjugation. It was significant that President Nixon heaped lavish praise on the Brazilian dictatorship after the official visit of the Brazilian president to Washington, declaring, quote, "As Brazil goes, so goes the rest of Latin America." We have also that same policy leading to the destabilization of the Allende government, and thereafter we find that not only communists and Marxists were hit by this anti-communist hysteria, also caught up were nationalists like João Goulart of Brazil, whose government was thrown out in 1964. Even an anti-communist but nationalist, Mohammad Mossadegh of Iran, who had nationalized the Anglo-Iranian Oil Company in 1951. The revolutionary democratic Juan Bosch of the Dominican Republic, and the social democratic Michael Manley of Jamaica. So here we have to see the consequences of this anti-communist hysteria attacking people who were not necessarily Marxist, but who wanted change, especially in the area of Latin America, Asia, and Africa, and the Caribbean. But not only was there military aggression, direct and indirect, but there was also economic aggression, ideological warfare, and political aggression. In the economic arena, all kinds of methods were used. Economic blockade, aid with strings, the curtailment of cutoff of credits, the denial of essential machinery and spare parts, and the imposition of economic planning strategies designed to perpetuate the status of dependency under dependent capitalism. And here we have the export of models immediately after the war and the Truman Doctrine, what is called the Puerto Rican model. And then came later the Alliance for Progress after the Cuban Revolution, the ECLA model by the Economic Commission of Latin America, then the regional integration system, and equal partnership, that is joint enterprises. All these were exported to so-called third world countries in order to contain these countries within the system of dependent capitalism, in keeping with economic philosophy of the Truman Doctrine. Then you had the Marshall Plan, by the way, which came in immediately after the war for devastated Europe. UNRWA was sabotaged, which was an aid, a scheme by the United Nations to give unconditional aid to those countries which had suffered in Europe. And because it was felt the socialist countries will benefit most from that, that was sabotaged. The Marshall Plan took its place, and governments, three of them, in France, Italy, and Belgium, which had united front governments with communist and left socialist, representing the underground resistance during Hitler occupation, those were destroyed on the ground that if they wanted martial aid, they have to kick out the communist and the left socialist. So that was the influence in Europe. In the third world, so-called third world, through the IMF and the World Bank, these international monetary institutions were subverted to serve imperialist interest and to foster in the third world the system of dependent capitalism, which has got all these countries today in serious trouble, manifested by the debt crisis.